let us start the something else. We are now at the far end of the chapter. We are talking about the energy consideration now. Okay, so basically we are discussing here how to write mechanical energy for the rigid body. Okay, so for writing kinetic energy or writing potential energy is very easy for a point mass or for a mass which is just going from one place to the other place without rotating. If a bigger mass, like let's say this glass, is just goes like this without rotating, then writing its kinetic energy is straightforward, half mv square. Okay, but while moving, suppose it starts rotating and it is moving forward, then every point on this glass will have different velocities. So which half mv square will you write? Or writing half mv square is correct? There is some issue with that. So that is what we are going to discuss, how to write kinetic energy for a rigid body and how to write potential energy for a rigid body. Even potential energy for a rigid body is not straightforward. For example, this glass is there at a height h. The bottom most point is at a height h from the floor. So should I write mgh or should I take the center? Should I take the topmost portion? Which height should I consider to write the potential energy? That is what we are going to derive here. And then once we know how to write down the kinetic energy of a rigid body and how to write down the potential energy of a rigid body, then what we can do once we know? Which concept we can use once we know how to write kinetic energy and potential energy? We can use work energy theorem. Okay. All right. So let us first see how to write kinetic energy for a rigid body. Kinetic energy for a rigid body. Now, if case number one, only translation without rotation. As in, only translation means without rotation only, but I specified it. Then all the points on rigid body have same velocity. Okay. So kinetic energy can be written as simply half capital M into V square. How does it come? Well, you can assume that the entire rigid body is made up of small point masses. So you can say M1 into V square plus kinetic energy of second mass M2 into V square. Like this, you will get if all the velocities are equal. So half of M1 plus M2 and so on into V square. So you can simply write it as half M into V square, okay? So here we have done it in a very simpler manner, right? You can consider the entire rigid body. For example, this is the rigid body and all the points, 1, 2, 3, 4, all the points, they're all moving at the same velocity. So you can just take one by one, add their kinetic energies, you will get half into total mass into V square, like that. This is the case number one, right? But this is not how things will be. This is the case which we have been using till now. But now we need to account for the rotation of a rigid body also. So case number two is about the rotation, about the fixed axis. Case number two, write down the rotation about the fixed axis. For example, fan. Now you can see that center of mass is not going anywhere. Center of mass is actually at rest, but still it has a kinetic energy. All the points, they have some speed. So there has to be kinetic energy for the fan-like scenario. So let's see how to write that. So suppose this is a rigid body, which is rotating about the fixed axis. This is the fixed axis, let's say. So you can see that all the points are moving in a circle because it is a fixed axis, right? So if the angular velocity is given to us as omega, you have this point mass m1 at a distance of r1, okay? Then what is the kinetic energy for mass m1? How to write it as half m1 into velocity of mass m1 square. What is the velocity of m1, everyone? Omega into r1, omega r1, right? So this you can write it as half m1 omega square r1 square. So this will be half m1 r1 square omega square. Fine. So the total kinetic energy will be like this. You have to add up all the kinetic energies, right? So half of m1 r1 square omega square plus half of m2 r2 square omega square and so on, all the points. This will be half. You can take omega square common. It'll be m1 r1 square plus m2 r2 square, so on into omega square. What is the bracket thing? What's the bracket? Moment of inertia, right? About what? About what? About the fixed axis. Okay, so if there is a rigid body, if there's a rigid body which is rotating about the fixed axis, then its entire kinetic energy can be written as half I about the fixed axis into omega square. You don't need to worry about anything else. All right? Clear, right? Now you can see there is a pattern in the equations. About the fixed axis, torque equal to I alpha. About the fixed axis, the angular momentum is I omega. About the fixed axis, kinetic energy is half IF omega square. Now, tell me one thing. Will the kinetic energy change depending on about which axis you're finding? Angular momentum and torque changes, right? Angular momentum and torque. Depend on axis. But do you think energy depending on axis, does it sound proper? Kinetic energy does not. Depend on axis. Are you getting it? So even though you are finding when you write kinetic energy is half IF omega square, you should not say that you have found kinetic energy about the fixed axis. Getting it? You are finding the kinetic energy of the rigid body by using an equation in which IF is there. Okay, so if there is a rigid body which is rotating about the fixed axis, you can write kinetic energy by using this formula. Clear? So this is case number two. Case number three. Is rotation plus translation. There is no fixed axis. Can you guess what should be the kinetic energy? You have seen how you have written the angular momentum. So similarly, can you guess kinetic energy? Okay, so with respect to the center of mass, it will be I cm into omega square plus half the center of masses kinetic energy. This is the formula. Please write it down. Okay, so Even if an object has a fixed axis, then also both formulas of kinetic energy gives same value. So you can use anything, but if there is no fixed axis, you don't have any other choice than to use this thing. All right. All of you clear how to write kinetic energy, everyone? Okay, so this is the kinetic energy. Let us see how to write gravitational potential energy for a rigid body. Today this chapter will get over. I think this chapter has taken 3 plus 2, 5 weeks to complete. So I hope those who have done it systematically, you can appreciate that your entire physics got revised. Whatever you have done in kinematics, laws of motion, work by energy, everything got revised in a single chapter again. Isn't it? So suppose you have a rigid body like this and you have to write the gravitational potential energy. This orange line is zero potential, is your reference gravitational potential energy, which is UG equal to zero. All right. Now how to write it? Again, I'll divide it into multiple point masses. Let's say there is a point mass over here, M1, which is at a distance of Y1. This is at a distance of Y1. M2 is there, which is at a distance of Y2, and so on. So I'll just write down the their individual potential energies and add them up to get the total potential energy. Total potential energy, the total mass, however, is capital M though. So total potential energy is M1 GY1 plus M2 GY2 and so on. Like this, right? I've taken one point masses and add up their potential energies. So add all the point masses one by one. This will be equal to M1 Y1 plus M2 Y2 and so on into G. What is the assumption when I write like this? Everyone tell me. What is the assumption here? Can you tell the assumption? G is constant at all points. Okay, that is the assumption. Correct. So you can add and multiply summation of all the masses, M1 plus M2 plus M3 plus M4, that you have multiplied and you have divided it also. What that will do? This divided by summation of M. What is this bracket term? What is this? If this orange line would have been x-axis, then what this would have been? Bracket term. Y center of mass, right? Y center of mass. So basically potential energy is summation of M into Y center of mass into G. Summation of M is what? Total mass. Y center of mass, you can write like this, height of center of mass, G. So potential energy, gravitational potential energy is MGH center of mass. Okay. This is how you write the gravitational potential energy. All right. So now we have learned how to write the potential energy for the rigid body and how to write the kinetic energy of the rigid body, no matter whether it is rotating or not rotating, about the fixed axis or not about the fixed axis, we can write the kinetic energy. Similarly, we can write the potential energy. So like what you said, we'll be utilizing this definition of kinetic energy and potential energy to put in work energy theorem, which is W is equal to U2 plus K2. Do you remember this work energy theorem, all of you? This we have done, I guess, 40 to 50 questions on work energy theorem. Better you not forget the rest of your life. Okay. So just one small thing before the break. If there is a pure rolling, or rolling without sliding, then at point of contact, there is no relative movement. Hence, work done by friction will be how much? Hmm. will be zero. So, you know, when the pure rolling is happening, don't start finding the work done by the friction, because that is zero. Okay. So if pure rolling is there, and no other force is doing work, then W is zero. W is zero, work done by friction is zero. So then U2 plus K2 is equal to U1 plus K1. So we can conserve mechanical energy. Potential energy plus kinetic energy is mechanical energy, and this is conservation of mechanical energy. Conserve mechanical energy. And you don't need to actually know this. You can just use whatever is written at the top of the page. You can use that also. I'm just telling you for simplicity's sake, right? So going forward, most of the cases, there will not be any dissipative forces, only friction will be there. Friction won't do work. So we'll be using U2 plus K2 equal to U1 plus K1 most of the time. And over here, potential energy is MGH of center of mass. Kinetic energy, you know, three cases, how to write the kinetic energy, right? So we'll, by the way, even though work done by friction is zero, is friction applying any force or torque, or even force and torque is also zero? Everyone, is the force and torque that also zero, or that is not zero? It applies force that creates acceleration. It applies torque that creates angular acceleration. All that are there. Okay, but the work done is not there. It can, I mean, it is little weird, right? It is weird in a way that this force can create acceleration. This force will cause the object to accelerate. This force will cause the object to rotate, but this force is not doing any work. Okay, so a little weird it is, but that's how it is. Okay, so after the break, we are going to take up questions on energy. Make sure, I mean, this is the last thing for the chapter. Make sure you end the chapter well, and this is an important thing. Okay, so we'll meet after the break at 6:20 p.m. Okay, come back. Okay, fine, so then continue. Let's take few basic questions, then we'll proceed further. For example, you have a rod like this. This rod can freely rotate about this axis. It is right now horizontal like this, and you're holding it. Then you release it, what will happen? It will go down like that. Okay, it will rotate and go down. Okay, so you need to find out what will be its angular velocity when it becomes vertical like this. Find out. Started from here, mass m, length l, it can rotate about this axis, and you need to find what is omega when it becomes vertical. Omega is how much? Okay. there is no friction and all, so you can use this, right, conservation of mechanical energy. Just substitute the values, get the answer. All of you do this. Which horizontal line you want to take as zero potential energy? Top, bottom most, which one? Bottom most, top. Okay, I think most of you have taken, no, it is half. Actually, it doesn't matter. But if you take the bottom most like this, then potential energy will be there initially as well as finally. Final answer won't get changed. So bottommost is not a appropriate choice. You choose in such a manner that at least one of the potential energy becomes zero. So you can take this top one as zero potential energy. That way, I guess it will be better, right? So U1 is how much? U1 is what? What should I write U1 as? Zero. K1 is what? Zero. U2 is what? What is U2? All of you tell me what is U2. You need to find out center of mass height, right? Center of mass is here. MgL by 2 or minus MgL by 2. There will be a minus sign, right? It is down. The center of mass has gone down. So negative, change in potential energy is negative. Potential energy has decreased. So minus of MgL by 2. How should I write kinetic energy in terms of omega? What will be the kinetic energy? Plus half. Is there a fixed axis? If there's a fixed axis, I can directly write kinetic energy as half I about the fixed axis into omega square. How much is the fixed axis moment of inertia? ML square by 3. ML square by 3 into omega square. Clear? Is this clear to everyone? Whatever I have just done, this is like the beginning of things to come. Omega is root over 3GL. No, 3G by L. All of you clear? Type in. Okay, simply you have to just, don't think too much with respect to applying energy conservation. You know how to write kinetic energy. You know how to write potential energy. Just write the equation and feed the values. Okay. Next. Suppose you have a slope. This theta. you have a sphere at the top. This is the sphere at the top, whose whose center is at a distance of h. This is the h. Okay, now it starts rolling and comes down. You need to find out what is the velocity of center of mass with which it moves forward. VCM is what? Of course, apart from VCM, it will have angular velocity, because I am telling you that it rolls without slipping. At no point there is a slipping. It is pure rolling everywhere. Pure rolling. Get the value of VCM and omega. Mass M and radius R is also given to you. Find out. Can pure rolling start without friction? Is friction required or not? If there is no friction, can there be pure rolling started? No. Friction is required. Friction is required for pure rolling, because only friction can create the torque. Initial angular velocity is zero. So if there should be angular velocity developing in this, there has to be some torque. Only friction can create the torque over there. Every other force is passing through the center of mass, right? Torque equal to ICM into alpha, right? So alpha will create omega. So friction is required. Pure rolling, if it starts, initial angular velocity is zero. In order to create omega, torque is required. That is why friction is required, because friction only can create torque. Do it. But friction is not doing any work. So you can use here U1 plus K1 equal to U2 plus K2. Now do it. Substitute the values. Get the answer. Archit got something. Others? Should I wait or start solving? This ground, you can take zero gravitational potential energy. UG is zero. Okay, Webo also got something. U1 is what? Initial potential energy. MGH. Kinetic energy is how much? K1 is zero. U2 is what? MgR, its center of mass is at a distance of R, right? K2 is what? How to write K2? Is there a fixed axis? there is a fixed axis or not? Actually, there is instantaneous fixed axis. Okay, so this point is at rest. There is a fixed axis, but okay, leave it. You don't need to write regarding that with respect to that. You can use the other formula, half mvcm square into half I omega square. That is also fine. So half icm omega square plus half m into vcm square. Is this equation clear to everyone? The one which I have written just now, all of you, whatever I have done, is this clear? Now this is rolling on a fixed surface, pure rolling on fixed surface. So what can I say? If it is pure rolling on fixed surface, what is the relation between omega and velocity, alpha and acceleration? What is the relation? A is equal to alpha r, right? And v is equal to omega r if it is pure rolling on a fixed surface. Okay, so I can use that. And moment of inertia about the center of mass for a solid sphere, how much it is? Two by five mr square. So ICM is 2/5 mr square. Omega is vcm by r. So v square by r square is omega square plus half m into v square. This is equal to m g h minus r. So you can see that m get cancelled away. M need not be given to you. Okay, so r square is also gone. So 7/5. So 7/10. 7/10. V square is equal to g times h minus r. So from here, velocity is root over 10 g. H minus R by 7. All of you clear? Any doubts, quickly type in. If it is clear, type in that it is clear. Okay. It is very simple. You just substitute the values of potential energy and kinetic energy. Straightforward. Right now, these are the straightforward school level or CET level questions. Let us see, you know, slightly distinct, so that once you do the difficult ones, then your school level will be very simple for you. Okay, so let's go ahead and do something else also. So next question is this. Suppose first we'll do that. There is a disc. It's not very difficult also. Okay, don't worry about all those. This is m radius r. This disc can rotate about this axis. This axis passing through the plane of the disc. Okay, this axis is at a distance of r/2 from the center. This distance is r/2. It can rotate about the disc, about the axis. It's like this. Assume that this is a disc. About this axis, it can rotate. So how it will rotate? It can rotate like that. Okay. So after it rotates one complete this thing, it will become like this. After having 180 degree rotation, if I nudge it like this, it is like this, it will become like that. Do you understand? It is like that. The disc is like this. you slightly push it, it will turn like that. Okay. All right. So you need to find out what will be the angular velocity when it flips 180 degree like that. Initial angular velocity is zero. You just nudged it and it goes down and gains some angular velocity. What is that? Omega is what? I hope everybody understood the question. If you have not, please ask. I'll clear it. Okay, Archit got something. Others? The formula is same. Same thing you have to use here also. Okay? That way there is no difference. All right. Okay. Should I solve or should I wait? You have to use that thing only. U1 plus K1 equal to U2 plus K2. There is no change to that. You can take this as zero gravitational potential energy. UG is zero. How much is U1? Everyone, what is U1? MgR/2. Isn't it? K1 is what? Zero. U2 is what? What is U2? Minus of MgR/2. What is K2? Is there a fixed axis for this rigid body? Is there a fixed axis? All of you? There's a fixed axis. So how can I write kinetic energy? How can I write kinetic energy? I moment of inertia about the fixed axis into omega square. Simple, right? So half I about the fixed axis omega square is equal to mgr. Fine. Now, moment of inertia about fixed axis is how much? IF. Can you find out? About this white line, how much is the moment of inertia? Okay, Aryan got it. Moment of, anybody else calculated the moment of inertia? How much is the moment of inertia about this axis that passes through the center of mass, but the diameter? How much it is? No, it is not that. Okay, do you know that about the natural axis, moment of inertia of the disk is mr square by 2? You know that? Right? Now, I want you to use parallel axis theorem, right? So, but then parallel axis theorem requires one ICM, and this is what I want, I. But this is not parallel to I. So I need to find axis that passes through the center of mass and parallel to this I. So I will use perpendicular axis theorem to find out the moment of inertia about this horizontal blue axis. Okay. So this will be equal to Ix plus Iy. Both are equal due to symmetry. So 2 times of ICM, I can say. So ICM, moment of inertia about the diameter, is mr square by 4. Getting it? So moment of inertia about this axis, how much? Mr square by 4 plus, this is ICM, plus m into the distance r by 2 whole square. So mr square by 4 plus mr square by 4, which is mr square by 2. All of you, is it clear till now? Type in. Till now, is it clear? So substitute this value of the moment of inertia about the fixed axis over there. You'll get half of this mgr. Omega is 2 times root of g by r. Anyone has any doubt? Okay, let's proceed further. Why can't we use parallel axis? Parallel axis we have used, right? Parallel axis we have used, which is ICM plus m into d square. This is ICM, this is m into d square. But mr square by 2 is not the parallel axis to I. I need to find axis passing through the center of mass and parallel to this, which is this blue line. It is not this line. This line is not parallel to that. It is perpendicular. Understood? So I have to first find out what is that blue line's moment of inertia. Okay, so there are some questions in which there is a collision happening. Okay, just like in the work power energy chapter, you need to use conservation of momentum, then conservation of energy. Similarly, there are a few questions here in which you have to use conservation of angular momentum and conservation of energy both. Okay, so for example, this one. We'll keep it simple. Suppose there is a rod which can rotate about this fixed axis. Okay. रॉड ऑफ मास एम एंड लेंथ एल, मास एम लेंथ एल, ओके, देयर इज अ स्मॉल मास एम कमिंग लाइक दिस विथ वेलोसिटी यू. Just before hitting the rod, its velocity is u, and after hitting, it comes to rest. After hitting, let's say it sticks. Okay, after hitting, it sticks to the rod. That will be interesting. Sticks to the rod. You need to find out the maximum angle rod will swing. How much? The rod will swing, sorry. You have to find what is this angle theta. The mass is stuck here. Can I conserve energy? Can I conserve energy directly from initial to the final point? Conserve mechanical energy before collision till the end. Can I do that? Everyone? Why? Those are saying no, why? What is the reason? Correct. Rohan got it. Yes. Good. So there is no, because energy is lost during collision. So you cannot. So what you have to do, first you have to go from before collision to after collision, and after the rod attains omega, from that point onwards you can conserve energy. Okay. So how do you get omega of the rod? Can I conserve linear momentum? Can I conserve linear momentum? Yes or no? during the collision, is there an external force in horizontal direction? Is there an external force in horizontal direction during the collision? What do you think, Rohan, Anirudh, Ritu, Pranav, Megha, Kiran, Gayatri, what do you think? Can I conserve the linear momentum horizontal direction? You cannot conserve it because there is reaction force from the hinge. Okay, there is this external force which is impulsive in nature. So how will you get omega? What you can do? What you can do? Which concept you will use? Right, conservation of angular momentum. About which axis? When you say I'll conserve angular momentum, you have to also decide which axis. About the hinge axis. About the hinge axis, we can conserve angular momentum. We can conserve angular momentum for rod plus mass. Okay, so initial angular momentum for the mass m is what? How much it is? What is the perpendicular distance? L, right? So mu into L. MUL, this is the angular momentum of the mass. Angular momentum of the rod is zero. This should be equal to what? Angular momentum of the rod plus mass afterwards, which is how much? Will the mass becomes part of the rod? Will the point mass after the collision becomes the part of the rod? Right? So entire thing is rotating about the fixed axis. So I can say this is equal to moment of inertia about the fixed axis into omega, because about that axis, angular momentum of everything. Now the mass is a part of the rod, is IF into omega. What is IF? How much is IF? ML square by 3, that's it. What about small m? Small m won't affect anything. Will moment of inertia increase or not? How much it will be? M plus m L square by 3. M, you're telling me M plus M, L square by 3 is the moment of inertia. It's like a rod of mass M plus M uniformly distributed. Is the mass uniformly distributed? Total M plus M? No. Right? So you need to add moment of inertia individually. Don't add the mass in the formula. There has to be some logic. So ML square by 3 plus small m into L square to omega. So moment of inertia of the point mass plus the rod about that axis will be their individual moment of inertia is adding up. Everyone clear? Clear to everyone? Okay. So this will give me omega. Okay. Assume omega is now known to you. You don't need to calculate. Suppose omega is now known. So I just made up the question. So probably the expression may not be look very nice, not look nice. So now tell me what is the angle theta, how much maximum it will swing. Find out. No, no integration. Conserve mechanical energy. You can write U1 plus K1 equals to U2 plus K2. Yes or no? Point number one is just after the collision. Point number one is just after collision. Point number two is when the maximum angle is there. Find out. Just write the expression. You don't need to calculate as such. Tell me once you're done. Do not try to find out cos theta or sin theta like that. Have you written the expression? Okay. Where is your zero potential energy? What do you want to take it as? Top at the hinge. Okay, fine. Take the top. Okay. Now U1 is what? U1. U1. Center of mass is this. Now you need to understand point number one is when the small m is already attached with the rod. The small m is attached and it has gained angular velocity just after the collision. Okay. So tell me now, for there will be two potential energy, of the rod, potential energy of the mass m. Getting it? Or you find out center of mass of both capital M and small m, then you can take it as one mass. But that is like unnecessary calculation. So we can split them and add them individually. Potential energy for the rod plus potential energy for the small mass. Tell me how much it is. Potential energy of the rod, do you all agree it is minus of mgl by 2? It is down, mgl by 2, potential energy of the rod. Tell me, is it clear? Right, plus the other potential energy is also negative, minus of small mgl. This is the total initial potential energy. Okay, if you consider this mass also, K1 is what? K1 is, let's call this thing as IF, ml square by 3 plus a small ml square, let's say IF. K1 is half of IF into omega square. All of you agree? IF is ml square by 3 plus a small ml square. Okay. This is equal to U2. U2 is what? Now this center of the rod is here. U2 is what? How much is this distance? This is the height you have to consider, right? How much it is? This is L by 2, right? This is theta. That is L by 2 cos theta. Use little bit of trigonometry, you will understand. So it will be minus of mg L by 2 cos theta. And for the small m, what is the potential energy? Tell me, minus of mg l cos theta. K2 is what? What is K2? K2 is zero. Okay. This is your equation number two. So these are the equations I was looking for. That's it. You have to solve these two to get the value of theta. Everyone clear? Anyone has any doubt in this? Clear. Last red box. Which part of the red box? It's a big box. Dekho, I have taken this. It depends on which horizontal line you take zero potential energy. I have taken this as zero potential energy, the top horizontal line. So using that, I have to write potential energy and kinetic energy. All right. Now, when I write potential energy, the formula for potential energy is mgh center of mass. Okay. Now, if you want to consider rod and mass, small m, as one single mass, you have to find its center of mass. Then you can write capital M plus small m g into h center of mass, which will not be L by 2. Okay. So rather than finding the center of mass and then writing M plus M g h center of mass, I have chosen to write their potential energies individually. For the rod, I have written potential energy minus mg L by 2. Then I have written for the mass and added them and tell that this is the total potential energy of the rod and mass M. Plus, the entire thing is rotating about the fixed axis, rod and the point mass. So moment of inertia of the entire rigid body, rod and point mass, is about the fixed axis, IF, that into omega square. Half IF omega square is the kinetic energy. So that is the kinetic energy plus potential energy. That I have equated to the final potential energy of rod plus final potential energy of the point mass plus the final kinetic energy, which is zero. Okay. Okay, so now you are experts of this chapter. Anyways, you can solve this quickly. I'm more interested in the third part. Or let's do this. You remember doing that question, right? Wherein there was a rod. There was this rod horizontally lying. Okay. There was a mass small m. This was going with velocity v. Okay. This is mass capital M. Total length is L. This velocity, line of velocity, is at a distance of L by 2. You remember that? Did we find out the immediately after collision? Immediately after collision, M comes to rest. We have done this, right? Somewhere we have done it. Do you remember this doing? Yeah. Okay. We have done this exact same question. Right. So we have got the value of omega and velocity center of mass. Tell me, what is the omega we have got? What is the answer for omega? Check your notes. Are you making it? Don't just sit without. ओमेगा आई एम आस्किंग, ओमेगा दिस इज द ओमेगा विच वी हैव फाउंड एंड वेलोसिटी ऑफ सेंटर ऑफ मास आफ्टर कोलिजन हाउ मच वी हैव गॉट इट एज हाँ दिस वॉज एल बाई फोर हाउ कैन इट बी एल बाई टू एल बाई टू विल बी एट द अदर एंड वी सी एम इज वॉट एम वी बाई कैपिटल एम ओके सो यू नीड टू फाइंड आउट हाउ मच द सेंटर ऑफ मास विल move forward one thing you I hope you might have noticed one thing no matter where this mass m hits this rigid body will always have a straight line center of mass velocity center of mass will always go in a straight line no matter where you hit you can try it after the class you can just put the pen on the floor which is almost like frictionless floor put it on the floor and just hit at one of the ends the pen you then just notice the center of mass the pen will rotate and move but the center of mass will always go in a straight line okay so that will go in a straight line with vcm you need to find out how much center of mass will move forward by the time rod rotates by 180 degrees find out Okay. So how much time will it take for it to rotate? Will it keep on rotating with constant angular velocity after collision, all of you? Will it keep on rotating with constant angular velocity after rotating? Everyone? After small m hits the rod, there is no other torque. Torque is zero. So whatever is the angular velocity, it will keep on maintaining that. Only when torque is there, change in angular velocity will be there, right? So angular velocity will be constant. So you can find out easily omega into t should be equal to pi. So from there, you'll get how much time it will take. for it to rotate by pi. So pi ml divided by 3mv. This is the time it will take to rotate 180 degree. Now, how much center of mass will move forward? Is center of mass moving with constant velocity forward with this only? After collision, is there any force on the rod? There is no other force. So the center of mass will also keep on moving with the constant velocity. So the distance d will be equal to the velocity v into the time by 3mv. Okay, clear? So you can see that it doesn't depend on the masses, right? So pi, it doesn't depend on the initial velocity also. So pi L by 3. It is independent of initial velocity, how much distance it will move, and it doesn't depend on the mass also. Okay, so like this, you can sometimes correlate what happens with the rotation with what happens in the translation. Now there are many, you know, there are many fine things which you will encounter while problem solving. So I cannot create infinite list of small things and teach you everything. Okay, so the theory part is long over. I am trying to cover what all things can help you in problem solving, but still there are many things you will learn by solving problem. No one can teach you each and everything that you will encounter in questions. Okay, this. Okay, is it kinetic energy is mgl by 2, many of you saying why? What is the answer for the first one? I mean, these are simple questions, guys. Don't think too much. Okay, so we know that K1 plus U1 should be equal to K2 plus U2. Okay, so initial kinetic energy is zero. Initial potential energy also you can say zero. initial final kinetic energy you have to find out. Final potential energy is minus of mgl by 2. So kinetic energy is how much? mgl by 2 only, which is option 4. Clear? It's straightforward. Okay, second part. Solve second part first. Angular velocity. What is the angular velocity, everyone? Prakul got angular velocity. Others, you need to calculate angular velocity. How much it is? Angular velocity, how much? How can you get Henge reaction without finding angular velocity? So question number 3 should be question number 2 and 2 should be 3. Kinetic energy is what? Half moment of inertia about the fixed axis, which is how much? M L square by 3 into omega square M G L by 2. So omega is root over 3 G by L. Okay, this is omega. Now find out the Henge reaction at point A. Now to the second question. Actually, yeah, anyways, find out. I didn't know the third question is about finding angular velocity. Draw the free body diagram, then only solve it. You're not experts. Even I don't skip steps. The moment you skip it, you get a wrong answer. Remember that every time, and you have enough experience of getting negative. Which direction the Henge reaction will be at point A? You can randomly say, okay, fine, there will be two directions the reaction can be. This one and that one. This reaction you can say Rx, this is Ry. You don't know which direction it is, right? What other force will be there? Any other force on the rod? All of you? Mg, how can you forget Mg, right? Mg is with you. Mg, any acceleration of the rod? There is no other force, right? On the rod, there is no other force. But is there any acceleration? Center of mass, do you agree it is moving in a circle? Is there an alpha? Someone is saying that there is an alpha. Is there an alpha? For alpha, there has to be a torque about the fixed axis. Is there a torque about fixed axis? No. There is no torque about a fixed axis. Right now there is no torque, but when it was not vertical, mg was creating torque because of which alpha was there. If you tell me that rod is like this, you know, for example, if you draw a rod like that, then because of mg, there is a torque about the center of mass, sorry, about the fixed axis. So there is alpha because of mg at that moment. But when rod becomes vertical, the mg passes through the axis, the fixed axis. So even mg's torque is zero about the fixed axis. So when it is vertical, alpha is zero. Do you all understand alpha is zero? Type in, I'm saying alpha is zero when rod is vertical. All of you understand this? So this implies that tangential acceleration is zero. Tangential acceleration is zero. Yes, Shraddha, I was saying alpha is zero because there is no torque about the fixed axis. Mg was creating alpha, but now even mg has zero torque. So net torque equal to I alpha about the fixed axis. So alpha is zero. So tangential acceleration is also zero. Is there a radial acceleration? Radial direction towards the center, is there any acceleration? All of you? AR, what do you think, everyone? How much it is, if it is there? The radial acceleration is how much? Okay, V square by R. In terms of omega, can I write it? V is equal to what? R is over here, the radius of the center of mass is L by 2, isn't it? This distance is L by 2 from here to here. V, how can I write V in terms of omega? Omega into L by 2, omega into L by 2 whole square divided by L by 2. So this will be omega square L by 2. Omega, or you just remember, in terms of omega, it is omega square r. In terms of velocity, it is v square by r. Okay. So now, how should I write the equation? What horizontal direction? There is no acceleration. There is no other force. Do you all agree that rx is equal to zero? Reaction horizontally will be zero when the rod is vertical. All of you agree with this? Rx is zero. Right, Rx is zero. Find out Ry. What will be the reaction for? What is the formula for Ry? What is the formula? Net force is Ry minus mg. This is equal to mass times acceleration, which is omega square L by 2. Net force is equal to mass and acceleration. Everyone understood this equation? Everyone understood? See, final answer, I don't care. I don't give a damn. Okay, don't just start yelling the answer. I am here to talk to you how to solve the question, not to check what answer you're getting. So, do you all understand this? Everyone type it. Right? Now put the value of omega over here. Put the value of omega over here. You will get 3 by 2 mg, right? 3 by 2 mg. So from here, you will get Ry equal to 5 by 2 mg. Okay. So this is how you solve this question. All right, so here you can see not only conservation of energy is utilized, but also the force equation is used. Sometimes you have to use angular momentum, energy, torque, each and everything you have to use sometimes in the question. Okay, so do not constrain your thought process that first you look like, okay, fine, what to use here, which formula to use, should I use this or that? You need to use whatever is required in that question. You have to think in a very open-minded manner. And that will happen only when you struggle with a lot of questions yourself. Fine. So I guess we can take one more question. I had this list of questions I thought I will do today, but I created my own this thing. There's something similar. This is, we have done something similar, Okay, I think we have done many of those similar types. Let me give you one question. Again, I'll just think over it. So you have a structure like this. You have two rods, mass M and length L, both the rods. They are welded at the center. Okay. Guns are installed. Guns are installed at the ends. Fine. This entire structure can rotate about the axis, passing through the center like this. Okay. The structure can rotate like that. Fine. Basically, I'm saying that it is free to rotate like that. Fine. So the guns simultaneous fire. Bullet of mass small m and with velocity small v. Okay, direction of the fire is as shown. Right? Mass m is very, very small compared to capital M. So capital M remains unchanged even if bullet is released. You need to find out what is the angular velocity immediately after bullet is fired. Do it. What concept to use here, all of you? First, tell me the concept. Collision? No, no. Can I conserve angular momentum? Now, work energy theorem, how can you use it? The firing will create a lot of energy loss, or chemical energy got converted into mechanical energy. So energy got, mechanical energy got created. You can't conserve it. Which concept to use here, all of you? Ajay, let me ask you that way. Can I conserve the angular momentum about this axis that comes out from your screen? Right? Not momentum, conservation of angular momentum. Momentum, though, forget, you can't conserve. Conservation of angular momentum you can do. About the natural axis. So initial angular momentum of everything is zero. So zero plus zero. Now, what is the angular momentum of all the bullets? Tell me. Angular momentum of bullets. For the bullets. Plus angular momentum for the rods. For bullets, what it will be? You can see the three bullets are in one direction. This one in this way, angular momentum that is that way, this is that way. So three bullets are having clockwise angular momentum. One has the anti-clockwise. So three times M into V into L by two minus M into V into L by two. Do you all understand this? Everyone understand that? This is the angular momentum for the bullets immediately after firing. Type in. Angular momentum for the rod is moment of inertia about the fixed axis, which happens to be the axis about which you are conserving the angular momentum. IF into omega. This will give me omega. IF is what? Tell me, IF is how much? ML square by 12 or ML square by 6. There are two rods, right? ML square by 12 into 2. Two rods are there. So ML square by 6 is the moment of inertia. All right. So you can, one more thing you can see here, that if angular momentum of the bullet is clockwise, the angular momentum of the structure will be anti-clockwise. Then only they will add up to zero. That is why omega will come out to be negative. Okay. So angular momentum of rod is negative of the angular momentum of the bullets. All right, guys. So I guess we have extended a bit, 5-6 minutes. So that's it. This chapter is over. All of you are now free to solve any question from anywhere from this chapter. Okay. So it's a huge chapter. We have spent about a month and a half to complete this chapter. You've done it in great detail. Right now, everything is fresh. Make sure that you do the homework and assignment in time so that later on you don't have to spend time in this chapter. Fine. So make sure that, sir, the center modules are even bigger. What do you mean by that, Kinshuk? So make sure you do the assignment. Yeah. So you can take the center module for the exercises. I'll put it as homework. Fine. So make sure you practice a lot of questions, your own. Then only you'll be comfortable with this chapter. Just sitting in classes is nothing. Okay. That everyone does. All right, guys. So we will meet next week with the new chapter, thermal physics. Till then, bye for now.